Hello everyone, I'm Balthazar Boer, and I'm happy to present a classification of computational assumptions in the algebraic group model, a joint work with Georg Fuchsbauer and Julian Loos. First, I will recall what is the algebraic group model. Then, I will explain how we classify many computational assumptions in this model. And finally, I will explain our separation result we obtain in this model. To understand the interest of the algebraic group model, we have to compare it with other computational models. So let's suppose that we are in a cryptographic context and an adversary receives from a challenger few group elements and computes a new group element Y. If we are in the generic group model, the group elements are not really known by the adversary. It just sees a purely random symbol, which are completely independent of their real values. And to compute new group elements, it needs to ask queries to an oracle, and this oracle will compute the group operation for the adversary and will send it to him the new symbol which correspond to the sum of the group element sent to the oracle. And because the oracle knows every group operation made by the adversary, because in reality she does herself these group operations, it means that the oracle can deduce how the adversary computes the group element of the output from the group elements of the input. And for this reason, if we change a little bit the model by forcing the adversary to output a scalar representation of the group element output, and when I say scalar representation, I mean we force the adversary to explain us how he computes this group element from the input elements, it does not change the model. It's equivalent to the generic group model. The algebraic group model is between the generic group model and the standard model. In this model, the adversary has access to the real values of the group elements, but it continues to give us the scalar representation of the group element output. It's really different of the generic group model, because in the generic group model, the adversary did not have access to the real information, and then we can do security proofs by using information theoretical arguments. But in the algebraic group model, because the adversary has access to the information, we can't use this sort of arguments, and we have to use reduction exactly like in the standard model. Now I've explained to you the difference between the algebraic group model and the generic group model. I would like to show you why this model is quite different of the standard model also. So, in the standard model, we don't know if D-log and CDH are equivalent. We know that D-log is harder than CDH, the computational Diffie-Hellman problem, but we don't know if D-log is strictly harder or not. But in the algebraic group model, we can show that these problems are equivalent, because if there exists an algebraic algorithm which solves the CDH problem, then we can build an adversary which takes as input a D-log instance, picks uniformly at random the scalar, then he asks a computational Diffie-Hellman solution of the triplet G, X and X plus VG, and receive from him Y, the CDH solution, and the scalar representation of Y. That is, coefficients L1, L2 and L3 such that L1G plus L2X plus L3X plus VG are equal to Y. And from this group equation, we can easily deduce a scalar equation in ZP. And because it's a very simple equation, it's just a quadratic equation, very simple, that we can solve with Berlekamp, for example. We can obtain two solutions, and one of these solutions will be the discrete logarithm of x in base g. And thus, the solution of the D-Log instance g and x. Finally, we have proved that in the algebraic group model, new security reductions are enabled. So it's a very promising model, and we would like to study many other computational assumptions in this model now. For example, we would like to study the Q Diffie-Hellman exponent assumption. In this problem, the adversary receives all the x to the I from I equal 0 to Q and should compute the next power of x in base g. This problem is a little bit more complex than CDH, but because the AGM seems powerful, it could be interesting to see if D-log is equivalent to QDHE in this new model. And because we are ambitious, we would like also study more complex assumptions, such as the Q-strong Diffie-Hellman assumption. This assumption is similar to the previous one, but a little bit more complex because we are in a bilinear context. Then the adversary receives two generators instead of one. And as output, the adversary chooses a scalar C and should output 1 over x plus c times g1. And even this assumption is complex, it would be a good result if we can show that it's equivalent to D-log. And I could continue to describe as many assumptions as there are in the literature. And for each of these assumptions, it could be interesting to check if they are equivalent to D-log in the algebraic group model. But it seems very laborious. So we have to use a powerful framework if we want to study all these assumptions. But fortunately, this powerful framework exists already. It's called the Uber Assumptions family, and it has been developed by Bonnet, Boyan and Go in 2005. This framework allows us to describe one assumption with very simple parameters. The parameters are a vector of multivariate polynomials R and one target polynomial which is P. And in this problem, the adversary receives all the Ri of x times g from I equal 1 to n with x which is a scalar vector picked uniformly at random, and the adversary should output P of x times g. Why this framework is so powerful? Because it covers assumptions such as ZDH. If R is equal to 1, X and Y, and P is equal to X times Y, then the Uber problem is completely the CDH problem. And it covers also assumptions such as the QDHE problem. Because if there is only one indeterminate, and if all the Ri's are equal to the monomials x to the I, and if p is equal to x to the q plus 1, then it's exactly the q dhe problem. So we can say that we have found a good way to describe many assumptions. But there is a little problem, because this framework describes also easy problem. For example, if P is in the span of R, then there is a very simple relation P is equal to sum of AI RI, and from this polynomial equality we deduce a scalar equality by evaluating this polynomial at x, and from this scalar equality we deduce a group equality, and from this group equality the adversary could easily compute the target from the group element of the input. But fortunately, Bonnet, Boyan and Go have shown that if this trivial relation was not satisfied, then these problems were hard in the generic group model. And for this reason, we hope to have interesting results in the algebraic group model. So we are happy, but there is a little problem, because QSDH is not covered by the Uber framework I've shown to you, for many reasons. Because we are in a bilinear context, also because the adversary can choose the target. When the adversary choose the C, it's like the adversary choose the target among this set of targets. And also because the target is no more a polynomial, it's a rational fraction. But our heroes, Bonnet and Boyan and Go, have shown that we can easily extend the framework for a bilinear context, also change the definition to have rational fractions instead of polynomials, and we can also authorize the adversary to choose the target himself among the set of all the non-trivial targets. Now we have found a way to describe many assumptions, we can reformulate our problem as: is it possible to reduce D-log to any non-trivial Uber assumptions? Unfortunately, we can't do this. But if we look a more general definition of D-log, which is QD-log, we could have some interesting results. So what is the QD-log problem? It's analog to D-log, except that the adversary receives all the x to the i times g to solve the D-log problem. To show you our results, I will focus on a simple case, which is the univariate case. In this case, there is only one indeterminate. So let's suppose that it exists an adversary against the RP Uber problem. Then, if all the RIs have degree upper bounded by Q, I can build an adversary against QD-log. How this adversary works? It takes as input QD-log challenge, and from this challenge, it will compute an instance for the Uber problem. It can do this because the RIs have degree upper bounded by Q. Then he sent to A the Uber challenge, and he receives from A a solution for this problem. And because A is algebraic, he receives also the scalar representation of P, the group element. Then he deduces an equation in the group G, and from this equation, exactly like in the CDH reduction, it deduce an equation in ZP. It's still a really easy equation to solve. It's just a polynomial equation in a finite field. And we have a few number of solutions, and one of these solutions is the discrete logarithm of x1 in base g. That is the solution of the qdlog instance. We can easily adapt our proof for a bilinear context, and if we embed the challenge in every coordinate in a multivariate case, exactly like for the CDH reduction, we can also prove an analog result for the multivariate case. Because we never use the fact that P is known at the beginning of the reduction, our proof works perfectly for the flexible target case. And also because every rational fraction equation could be transformed into a polynomial equation, our proof could be also adapted for the rational fraction case. And finally, exactly like Bonnet Boy & Co, our security proof cover QSDH. For this reason, we are happy. But we are not so happy because we see assumptions which are not covered by the Huber framework. For example, the gap Diffie-Hellman assumption. In these assumptions, the adversary receives a CDH challenge and has access to an oracle which knows how to solve the DDH problem. And this problem is not covered by the previous definition of the Huber framework. What we have to do? We have to extend the definition to cover gap Diffie-Hellman. So we are happier, but we are not completely happy, because there are other assumptions which are not covered by the Huber framework. For example, the LRSW assumption. In this assumption, the adversary can choose M star and A star and output the polynomial A star times X plus M star times XY as a target. But the adversary does not output A star. He outputs A star times G. And these little modifications let LRSW outside of the Huber family. So we have decided to extend again the definition and authorize the adversary to choose a new generator and return it as output with of course the target. With these new definitions, we cover many group assumptions. And as you can see, it looks like there are some classes which characterize the hardness of the cryptographic assumptions. But now we would like to know if these classes are really different or not. For example, we would like to know if in the algebraic group model, D-log is equivalent to 2D-log. And more generally, if Q minus 1 D-log is equivalent to Q D-log in the algebraic group model. And if it is the case for each Q, it means that D-log is equivalent to all the Huber assumptions in the algebraic group model. And it would be a really interesting result. But unfortunately, we can't prove such result for every Q, because we proved that if it exists a reduction algebraic from q delog to q plus 1 delog, then it implies that q delog is easy. And for this reason, we think that the classes are really different. So we didn't prove that D-log is equivalent to every Uber assumptions, but we have a map interesting to describe the hardness of many assumptions. Now we would like to know if there exist group assumptions which are not in this map. A good candidate is the one more discrete log assumption. In this assumption, the adversary should compute two discrete logarithms and asks one oracle to compute one discrete logarithm. It seems hard, but we have shown that this assumption was not implied by any QD-log assumption. Now I've presented to you all the main results of our paper. I would like to thank you for your attention and I wish you a good day.